Now will you please rise in body or in spirit and join me in our call to worship. From north and south and east and west, all creation sings forth your praises. The mountains and the hills burst into song. The trees of the field shall clap their hands. Your steadfast love never ceases. With joy and peace, let us worship God together. Be seated. God's grace was given to us in Christ before the ages began. Despite God's love for us and gift of love to us, we often act in destructive and hateful ways. Trusting in Christ's mercy that never ends, let us with honesty confess our sins before God and one another. Let us pray. Merciful God, you have called us to live in sincere faith and to suffer for the gospel. We confess that we do not come before you with a clear conscience. Our faith is clouded by sin and uncertainty. We shrink from your call to live sacrificially on behalf of others. Too quickly, we see our own ease and comfort first. We confess that in our own lives and in the church, we rely on our power rather than yours. Forgive us, we pray, for we are fractured and fearful disciples. Take away from us a spirit of cowardice and restore to us the spirit of power rightly used, of love unconditionally offered, and of a self-discipline gracefully lived. In new mercy, forgive us and increase our faith that we may be faithful servants at your table. Hear the good news. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies are new every morning. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Let us pray. Healing sovereign God, overmatch our resistant ears with your transforming speech. Penetrate our jadedness and fatigue. Touch our yearnings by your words. Through your out loudness, draw us closer to you. Connect with us as we connect with others. We are ready to listen. Amen. The reading of Paul's letters this morning is 2 Timothy 1, verses 1 through 14. It can be found in your pew Bible on page 199. It is said Paul wrote this letter from his second Roman imprisonment. Here, Paul charges Timothy and all who are purchased by the blood of Christ to guard through the Holy Spirit who dwells in us the treasure which has been entrusted to you. Listen to the word of the Lord. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus, our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day, recalling your tears. I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother, Eunice, and now, I am sure, lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed, then, of the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel and the power of God, who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to this own purpose, his own purpose and grace. And this grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began. But it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel, I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. And for this reason, I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard the deposit I have entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of sound teaching that you have heard from me, and the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good deposit entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us. The word of the Lord. Thank you.
Here we go. Our second scripture reading comes from Luke chapter 17, verses 5 through 10. The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." The Lord replied, "If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Would any of you say to your servant who had just come in from the field after plowing or tending sheep, 'Come, sit down for dinner'? Wouldn't you say instead, 'Fix my dinner, put on the clothes of a table servant, and wait on me while I eat and drink? After that, you can eat and drink. You won't thank the servant because the servant did what you asked, will you? In the same way, when you have done everything required of you, you should say, 'We servants deserve no special praise. We have only done our duty.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, our time with children, hopefully they'll watch this later. I'm guessing everyone who's listening knows what mustard is. You might even have a strong opinion about whether you want it on your hot dog or not. But have you ever seen a mustard seed? They're pretty tiny. Well, Jesus tells his friends a couple different stories about mustard seeds, and so I want to read some of this story called The Marvelous Mustard Seed by Amy Jill Levine and Sandy Eisenberg Sasso. A child plants a mustard seed in an empty garden. It is an itty-bitty seed. It isn't anything very special yet. Mustard seeds are so small that you have to look hard to see them. You have to look so hard to see them that you need to get really close. There's not much to be done with a single teeny-weeny seed. You can't eat it or wear it. You can't take it for a walk or cuddle with it. You can't write or blow bubbles with it. The only thing you can do is plant it in the soil. And then the rain falls and the sun shines, and things begin to happen in the earth. But no matter how hard you look or how close you get, you can't see the tiny seed. The seed is hidden, down with the moles, down, down with the ants, down, down, down with the earthworms. And then it happens. In the place of the little bitty seed, up comes a shoot. Up, up comes a sprout. Up, up, up comes a bush. And I'm going to stop reading there. The authors have some fun imagining what might become of that plant. And we can read that together another time. But the kids in the book show us that a mustard seed doesn't seem like much. And I wonder if you've ever felt like that mustard seed, like you're too small to do much. But when Jesus tells the stories about the mustard seed, he tells his friends that even though it's teeny tiny, and you can't eat it or play with it or take it for a walk, it can turn into something big and special and important. Jesus knew that really important things could happen with things that as small as a mustard seed. So let's pray. Dear God, sometimes we feel small, but you teach us that small things are important too. Help us see ways that we can love you and our neighbors in big ways and small. Amen. So this week we begin a four-week series based on the words of Jesus in Luke that directly or indirectly teach us about prayer. In some ways, he teaches us more about what not to do than what to do. My hope is that this exploration will empower us all to speak to God more boldly and honestly. When it comes to prayer, as I've said before, we need not worry about doing it wrong. Prayer is a way of practicing dependence on God, and God knows us, and God knows we're not perfect. So we should be relieved of any anxiety about how to pray and instead be encouraged to approach prayer as honest, unfiltered conversation with God. I'm grateful to Pastor Brian Erickson, who frames the passages from Luke 17 and 18 that we'll be exploring as prayers that don't work. So what's the prayer that doesn't work in this conversation between Jesus and his disciples? It is the prayer to have enough faith to have no need for faith. So in Luke, we follow along on the journey with Jesus and his disciples. And today's passage comes after Jesus' teaching with a series of parables. There are those famous ones, the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son. And then we get a little more difficult. The parable of the dishonest manager, followed by the one about the rich man and poor Lazarus. And then just before today's verses are teachings about repentance and forgiveness. And you have to wonder what it was like accompanying Jesus on this journey. Not just the physical journey, but the journey that is Jesus' way. It's got to be exhausting trying to keep up. By nature of being followers, they are always at least one literal and metaphorical step behind. And as the journey continues, the steps get more difficult. So after teaching through this string of parables that are increasingly more challenging, Jesus warns them about sin and tells his disciples, his friends, that they must forgive those who wrong them until they lose count. Really. If someone sins against me seven times in one day and each time comes back to me and swears they're changing their ways and it will never happen again, I'm supposed to just keep forgiving. Seven times, over and over again, until I lose count. You can understand why, overwhelmed by the increasingly heavy load that they think they're taking on by continuing to follow in Christ's way, that they throw up their hands and offer this desperate prayer, increase our faith. Please, we need help, more faith to be able to do all these things that you keep telling us to do. And Jesus' response is baffling at first. I imagine folks both within the church and outside the Christian faith hearing this for the first time might find the faith that Jesus talks about at best strange and irrelevant, and at worst misleading and dangerous. When the disciples ask Jesus to increase their faith, he speaks to them about a faith that even in its smallest quantity, just the size of a mustard seed, has the power to make miracles happen. And then he goes on to reprimand the disciples to think of themselves as worthless servants. Jesus says, if you have had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, go jump in a lake, and it would do it. In Matthew's version of this mustard seed saying, Jesus answers the disciples' question about not being able to cast out a demon, saying that if they had faith the size of a mustard seed, they could tell this mountain move and it would move. There's nothing you wouldn't be able to tackle. And he makes it seem so easy. But faith is, by nature, incredibly difficult. Erickson says, faith implies a willingness to deal with uncertainty, to depend on what you cannot see, and to trust what you cannot know. And it never feels like enough, which is why it's called faith. Even 2,000 years after the disciples first offered this request of Jesus, it is not uncommon for his followers to want to trade in their current faith for something a little more substantial. In making this request from Jesus, the disciples show that they know faith is a gift. They know it's not just a matter of trying harder or following a new 10 steps to greater faith plan. So they ask for more faith. They ask for it from the one who actually can give it to them, the source of our faith. And who among us does not want to have more faith? Were we to be standing face to face with Jesus of Nazareth in the flesh, would we not ask the same thing among other requests? But Jesus doesn't want to hear any of that. He declares that the quantity of faith is not the problem. The lack of faith is not the problem. The real problem, he says, is a lack of understanding about the nature of faith. Erickson thinks we often wish to trade in faith for her shinier cousins, like knowledge and confidence. But those more appealing virtues place the control squarely in our own hands, which is not the nature of discipleship. Faith is less shelter and more sending, less calculation and more chaos. Ouch. I think he's right, though. We'd much prefer knowledge and confidence to faith. Maybe a little more control and a little less surrender. In our Presbyterian Book of Confessions, there's a question in the Heidelberg Catechism that asks, what is true faith? And the answer is a reminder that faith is not about control or confidence. The answer says, true faith is not only a sure knowledge by which I hold as true all that God has revealed to us in Scripture. It is also a wholehearted trust which the Holy Spirit creates in me by the gospel that God has freely granted. These are gifts of sheer grace, granted solely by Christ's merit. The only confidence we have when it comes to faith is the knowledge that faith is a gift from God, in whom we can trust wholeheartedly. And that's great, right? But in the moment, we might like a little more. Knowing the difficulty still to come on the journey when the disciples ask Jesus for more faith, he responds by asking for something small, a trusting faith the size of a mustard seed. It is that kind of faith that relies on the strength of Jesus, not the follower. That trusting mustard seed size faith relies on the power of the Holy Spirit at work within the follower. I appreciate Professor Kim Long's reframing of Jesus' response here. She points out that we have come to expect a steady dose of condemnation from Scripture. And many a Scripture reading and sermon have tried to use shame or guilt to get a faithful response out of the hearers. Long says, these perceptions stand as barriers between themselves and a God who loves them. What if Jesus is not scolding the apostles at all? What if he's not clucking his tongue and shaking his head over their lack of faith, but speaking these words in a voice of encouragement and love, as one who would give up his life for his friends, for us? What if? What if Jesus' response to his disciples' desperate prayer to have enough faith to have no need of faith is not a reprimand, but a reassurance? What if his words are spoken not to shame or guilt his disciples, but to love and encourage them? Can you imagine Jesus answering his friends' plea for more faith, not with eyebrows furled and finger wagging, but with a smile on his face? Can you hear words spoken with love? Why, you don't need more faith. Even this much faith is enough. Long says that knowing the disciples think they are not up to all that Jesus calls them to, he changes the question from how much faith is enough to what is faith for. He tells them, she writes, through image and story, you already have the faith you need. Now fulfill its purpose. Live it. you already have the faith you need. I wonder if Jesus' friends heard it like that. I can imagine that they might have assumed that as they followed and learned more, that their faith would grow and they'd know more, and eventually this discipleship thing would come naturally to them, get a little easier. I think that happens to us too. We think that maybe someday we'll have more faith. Maybe someday we'll be able to trust a little more and fear a little less. When it comes to acts of faith, like our financial stewardship, we know that the amount of our generosity is not a direct reflection of how faithful we are. But still, we wait until we feel like giving, or until we've got just a little more put away for our kids' college funds, or the stock market stops being so erratic, or we feel more confident in our government, or until what? Until all the conditions are favorable? And we convince ourselves that we are being responsible, not reluctant. But it's never easy, is it? Hopefully it gets easier as we keep practicing our faith and trusting in God. Erickson says, faith and ease are not good partners. Faith leads us out into that place where we are more aware than ever of our need, our lack, our dependence. Because it is only in that fragile state that we will discover the one who can move mountains. In this way, faith is not so much something that we possess, but something that possesses us, beckoning us into the life that only God can offer. I will admit that I can stand here and say that God is the source of all good gifts, faith included, and I sometimes forget to trust in the one who is the source of all good gifts, at least for certain things. As your pastor, I can get anxious about the budget and the nominating committee and many other things. Friends, I know it doesn't always feel this way, but there is plenty of faith here in our congregation. We already have the faith we need. Enough to get mulberry bushes to jump into the sea. Enough to move mountains. Enough to do all that God is calling us to do as a community of faith here and now. Enough to change the world. The question isn't about whether we have enough faith. The question is, how do we live out the faith that we have? We live it out through all that we have learned from those teachings and parables, including the ones that are hard to swallow. We live it out by forgiving over and over again until we lose count, not because we are stronger or have some superpowers, but because God gives us what we need to flourish abundantly in faithful community. The question isn't whether we have enough faith. It is about learning that we are all in this together. Faith is not about knowledge, control, or confidence. Faith is about not being afraid to ask questions, express doubts, or show weakness. Faith is about not being afraid to value mercy over fairness, or to forgive one another's failings even when patience wears thin. When we discover the power of faith we already have, we realize that we don't need to pray for more faith, but to pray that we might understand and live out the faith that is already within us. We have confidence not in our own faith or ability or knowledge or control. We have this hope not because of the believer, but because of the one we believe in. Amen.
Thank you.
We are glad to have you joining us in worship. If you are looking for a church home, we would love to have you join us here at St. Andrew's, and I'd be happy to talk with you about how you can become a member. Hope you will continue to check out all the different ways we communicate what's going on in the life of the church so you can find places to connect. A reminder that we will have a congregational meeting after worship today to elect members to the nominating committee. This is a hybrid meeting. Hopefully it's going to be working by then. Those of you joining on YouTube, just stay right there on the site. And after the benediction and music, the meeting will begin. We'll be using the live chat feature on YouTube so that members joining us online can participate too. And I'll say more about that when the time comes. I do want to point out that this morning we started our Sunday morning together fellowship and educational time in Hefner Hall at 9 o'clock, and you are welcome to join us. That'll continue for 3 more weeks this month. And I hope you will continue to remember those on the prayer list that we send out to our worshiping community. And especially we remember our neighbors near and far, those in Ukraine and Russia and the surrounding areas, and all those affected by the hurricanes. And now I'd like to invite Merle and Margaret to come forward and share our Minute for Ministry today.
Together, we are the M&M team for Mission Ministry. We're here to share with you for just a few minutes today to feature two of the programs that we are supporting through our mission efforts. The first one I'd like to point out that to share with you today is that our Peace and Global Witness offering, which is being collected today, the local portion, the 25% that is available to us as a congregation, will be going to New American Pathways. This is a social services group for asylum seekers and refugees here in the Atlanta area, and they're right here in our backyard. Their office is over on Henderson Mill, right over by Northlake Mall. These folks receive and support refugees coming into the Atlanta area, and very specifically into the Clarkston community. Right now, the entire refugee system here, throughout the country really, is experiencing a crisis in trying to process and support all the refugees who fled from the fall of Afghanistan in early September of last year. Everyone who came in September, their application deadlines fell this month during the month of September. 2,000 immigrants came to Atlanta here alone and need to go through the process of applying for asylum now that they've been given humanitarian parole. So everybody is squeezed into having to do all this process in a very short time. The money that we can give to New American Pathways will help them to provide these services that they had no forewarning of and no ability to prepare or get ready for. New American Pathways has been around since 1980. It's been here before I got to the Atlanta area. And their mission is to support helping refugees. New American Pathways is an Atlanta-based nonprofit with the mission of helping refugees and Georgia thrive. They have an incredible track record, including 98% of their clients' citizenship applications are approved. Applying for U.S. citizenship is a very complicated, lengthy process, and that's an incredible statement. So some of the monies donated today will go to that cause. The other portion will go to PCUSA to support global ministries, especially seeking to take care of individuals and to seek peace in our lifetime. Margaret's going to tell you about some other stuff we're doing.
Big things are happening at networks. If you haven't heard, the Networks Cooperative Ministry, which I was shocked to hear is 18 years old now. And we were there from the beginning. It just, time flies when you're having fun, let me tell you. They have long outgrown their current facility, which they have been very thankful for, but they have, the need has increased so much that they just don't have the room there. So it seems almost magical, the facility that they have found, which is over on Cowan Road near the middle school, so still right in the heart of Tucker and very convenient. And it's going to be, it seems almost designed to, for exactly what they what their needs are. It is a climate controlled, they have a good bit of climate controlled warehouse space in the new facility, which is perfect because what they want to do is have a grocery style food pantry where people can come in as and shop for their own food choices with nutritional assistance. Their networks has always been a group that treats everyone with dignity. And let me just give you a fact, one fact. 1 in 8 Georgians faces food insecurity. That means they do not know where their next meal is coming from. 1 in 8. That's shocking to me. And many, many of these food insecure persons are children. So one of the best things about the new facility is that there will be a big walk-in cooler, which will allow networks to distribute perishables, which have been a struggle up until now. And they'll have plenty of space for their grocery, I can't remember what it's called now, but it used to be called the Food Co-op. Now it's called the Grocery Alliance. And these are groups that get together and get their food from the Atlanta Community Food Bank and distribute it, and they do all the work themselves, and it's a community building experience within the little group. And so they've been limited to the days that they can provide this service at networks, but their hours will increase anyway. I could go on and on and tell you about many of the things. Camille and I both had a chance to see a sneak peek of the new facility, and it's emotional, actually, to see it. It's going to be wonderful. The thing is, when we were there a couple of weeks ago, they said they were hoping to open by the end of October. Well, it's October. So we haven't yet heard about when there'll be volunteer training, but I want to say that if like me, you've always wanted to volunteer at networks but weren't really sure how to go about it, this is a fantastic time to jump in, because everything will be new. There'll be a whole new system of doing things, and there will be volunteer training coming up. We'll let you know as soon as we hear about that. There also will probably be some just last minute pre-opening tasks that we may be able to help with, so just keep your eye open for if we send out a frantic email saying, can someone come and help build shelves or paint something. So we're just very excited about that, and wanted to let you know that things are happening at networks. Also, just a note, we do still have openings in October and November. That would be October 23rd and November 27th to provide meals for the Clifton shelter. So it's a very easy thing to do, even if your family or your Sunday school group or anybody would like to get together. It's just to take food for 15 men and you drop it there, and it's a good way to support them as well. So all of these things have to do with hunger. We're very thankful for everything that this congregation does. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Merle and Margaret, for sharing what the mission ministry has been up to, and hope you all will take advantage of ways to connect and love our neighbors in this way. And as they mentioned, this is because it is World Communion Sunday, we do take up the Peace and Global Witness offering that's used to expand global witness while maintaining Presbyterian's long-standing commitment to working towards peacemaking and reconciliation, especially in cultures of violence. So we will have a special offering with our regular offering today, and those offerings will be divided up locally with the organizations you heard about and shared globally through the denomination to work in reconciliation in this broken world. And if you would like to give to this special offering or contribute a financial gift to St. Andrew's, you can do so by mailing a check to the church. Through online giving, you can also find a link for that at the bottom of our webpage. And this being the first Sunday of the month, you are also invited to bring your change for children to support the Alliance for Children Everywhere. You can place those in the basket in the narthex or contact the church office. Paul writes, "I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you." So as we have received gifts from our faithful God, let us faithfully place those very gifts in God's service. And you are home to exiles. Accept, we pray, the offerings we bring this day. Use them according to your own purpose and grace. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. You may be seated. Friends, Christ's table is wide and his welcome is for all. Jesus dined with sinners and saints, with farmhands and foreigners, with disciples and doubters, with children and cherished friends, with the outcast and the outspoken, with lepers and loved ones. And just as he ate at others' tables, when Christ set his banquet table, he welcomed us all too. As we gather around Christ's table, we are united with all of God's beloved across the world through the love and grace made known in bread broken and cup passed. So come, all of each of you, to the table where we witness Christ's love and peace for all. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. We give you thanks and praise, God of all creation, for the blessing of your earth and all your children, for the mercies you pour forth in fresh rains and harvests of plenty, for joy that comes in the morning. We are a grateful people. You created a world of harmony and peace, but our yearning for power and privilege throughout history led to division and conflict, suffering and violence. We give thanks that you sent prophets and poets to lament and remind, to bear witness and call us to yet a better way, to write the vision of a peaceable kingdom for all to see. We give you thanks that in the fullness of time you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to bear witness to your mercy, grace, and love. In his living, he showed us how to love. In his dying, he offered us undeserved mercy. In his rising, he granted us grace. Through the gift of faith, even faith as small as a mustard seed, his witness rekindles in us the gifts of God, not so that we can hold on to these gifts for ourselves, but so that we can be united across the globe as one family of faith, gathered around one table, sharing in one holy meal, sustained by a love that binds us together in peace. Now pour out your Holy Spirit upon our many tables, trusting that Christ is the host of our sacred meal together. May the blessing of grain from the earth and fruit of the vine be a reminder of the true joy of communion that unites us in one worldwide covenant of love. Sustained by your word, fed by this holy meal, may we go out with joy and be led forth in peace through Christ our peace. We pray this all in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors.
and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. A few instructions again as we gather at this table that extends beyond this space. Today we are sharing the Lord's Supper by intinction. You're invited to come forward with your pew to the center. You hold out your hand and the server, me, I will put a piece of bread in your hand, and then you can dip it in the juice and eat it and return to your seat. We'll also have the station with gluten-free that has individual cups of juice as well. We'll have a rover who will bring this meal to you if you choose not to come forward, and we also do have the individual packages available if you need one. And as we share in communion here in the sanctuary, those joining us online are invited to eat bread and juice and whenever, wherever you may be. When Jesus invited everyone to his table, he wanted no human barriers to stop people from celebrating this joyful feast. And we hope to do the same. Now, friends, on the night of his arrest, our Lord Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do so in remembrance of me." And the Apostle Paul reminds us that every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's saving death until he comes again. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come.
Let us pray. God of grace, mercy, and peace, you gather us together at your table, a people mindful of the world's pain. We remember the places where violence reigns, homes which are not safe, lands torn apart by war, families broken by betrayal. Amidst the tears and pain, bring your healing touch, your compassionate comfort, and your reign of peace. We remember the leaders of this nation and all the nations of the world. Guide them in your grace and mercy that they might actively seek peace in all things. We remember those who suffer, those struggling with physical illness, robbing them of rest, sapping them of strength, pressing them with pain, accelerating the approach of death. Those struggling with mental illness, cutting their confidence, snatching their joy, compromising their sense of reality, shaking their sense of security. Those oppressed by systems, by neighbors, by circumstances, by sin. Alleviate all suffering as only you can. We give thanks for the church, visible and invisible, in this present age and in all times and places. Make us one in you and at your table. Grant that we all may be faithful in our work of living our faith in you. This we call to mind, and therefore we have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. For all these things we pray through Christ our risen Lord. Amen. In your pews after the benediction and music for our brief congregational meeting. And now go out into the world in a little bit to live your hopes and not your fears, knowing that you are held in holy hands that will never let you go. Alleluia. Amen. And may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. You may be seated.
Thank you.
meeting to order and welcome Linda Robinson, who is serving as our clerk for the meeting. And do we have a quorum? We have a quorum. Let's open with prayer. Eternal God, you call us to be a special people, to preach the gospel and show mercy. Keep your spirit with us as we meet together, so that in everything we may do your will. Amen. Okay. Are we on YouTube? I need to give instructions. Are we on YouTube Live? We're on YouTube Live. Okay. Here's what we're going to do. Those of you joining us online can ask questions and make motions and second and vote in the chat on YouTube Live, just like those in this room. Ashley is going to sort of be monitoring that chat feed, so if there's a question, David's monitoring it. All right. We've got it covered. Thank you for your patience already. We might need a little bit of more patience to make sure we don't have anybody commenting or anything online. We don't want to miss them because we're just plowing ahead here. Do we have people watching us live? Can we tell? Zero. All right, we're trying. I was going to have them test out and comment in the little chat that they're here, but they're not. Sorry about that. Okay, so the purpose of our meeting is to fill vacancies on the nominating committee. Our returning members of the nominating committee are Carol Gordon and Deb Chambers. And so on behalf of the nominating committee, which includes, in addition to Carol and Deb, Mike Bearden, Marge Holler, and Margaret Williams, I present the following nominees: Nancy Davenport, who will be representing the session, Jackie Harper, and Pat Zarolka. Those are the nominations from the nominating committee. They don't need seconds, but I will open the floor for additional nominations. If you would like to make a nomination, in theory, you will have already asked the person, they will have agreed. I don't see any. Can I have a motion to close nominations? So moved by Charlton. Do we have a second? Yes, from David. Second from David. All right. All in favor of closing nominations, please say aye. And like sign opposed, say no. All right. Now we have the slate before us as presented, Nancy, Jackie, and Pat. And I will call the question. All those in favor of electing this slate, please say aye.
Aye.
And all those opposed, say no. All right. Thank you, Nancy, Jackie, and Pat, for agreeing to serve with Carol and Deb. Just a reminder now, if you haven't already, be thinking about who you think God may be calling to serve as elders and deacons in the years ahead. Have conversations with them. Let me know. Let any of these nominating committee members know, because we'll be working on filling that next slate for you. Now, do we have a motion to adjourn? So moved by Charlton, a second. Second from Merle. All in favor of adjourning, say aye. All opposed, say no. And I will close us with prayer. Thank you, Lord, for being with us. Now, as we continue to be your church, guide us, lest we stumble or be misguided by our own desires. May all we do be done for the reconciling of your world, for the upbuilding of the church, and for your greater glory in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now you may go in peace. Thank you. Oh, we did, sorry, and I didn't take a vote. Yes.